Hello, welcome back to this lecture series on Huckel molecular orbital method. In this lecture, I am going to discuss how to apply the rules of Huckel molecular orbital method to some of the systems. Okay. Let's get started. First, I am going to apply this method to the molecule ethene. Right, this is the simplest one. So we start with the ethene. Okay, we know very well the molecular formula of ethene is C2H4, and the structure is, you know very well, there will be carbon-carbon double bond, and each carbon atom is connected with the two hydrogen, okay, with sigma bonds. So here between carbon we have a single sigma bond and we have a pi bond. Okay, so we have one pi bond. Whenever we have pi bond, yes, you can apply Huckel molecular orbital method. And you know very well, Huckel molecular orbital treatment is applicable only for pi bonds. Okay, now, so to apply Huckel molecular orbital method, what we have to do? We should keep all the sigma bonds in one plane. Assume that the entire sigma bonds of the molecule present in one plane. Let it be XY plane. Okay, and each carbon atom has a p orbital perpendicular to the plane, and these two are actually 2pz orbital of carbon, 2pz, and each p orbital has one electron. Okay, let the wave functions of this atomic orbital, okay, let me represent that as phi1 and phi2. So remember, phi1 and phi2 are the atomic 2pz atomic orbitals, okay, of carbon atom, right? And these wave functions can be obtained from some of the basis that is available. Okay, so what I am trying to say, phi1 and phi2 are the wave functions, are the wave functions of 2pz atomic orbitals of carbon. Okay, and these two wave functions we can choose from the available basis sets. We have many basis sets are there, so you can choose from that. Okay, so phi1 and phi2 are known. That's the point you should keep in mind. Now what I'm going to do, these atomic orbitals, okay, combine and form molecular orbitals. Okay, so atomic orbitals, that is phi1 and phi2, phi1 and phi2, they combine linearly, it's called linear combination of atomic orbital, will give two molecular orbitals. We'll get two molecular orbital. Let me represent that in the energy order. We'll get two molecular orbitals. Okay, the lower energy molecular orbital, since they are pi molecular orbitals, I'll represent this as pi1 and this is pi2. The lower one is bonding, the higher one is antibonding. Okay, so linear combination of the two atomic orbitals will form two molecular orbitals. One having lower energy is called bonding molecular orbital, the other one having higher energy is called antibonding molecular orbital. Right, I have represented that as pi1 and pi2 star. And these molecular orbitals have wave function. Let me represent that as psi1 and psi2. Right now, we don't know what is the exact form of the wave function psi1 and psi2. But I am going to take this as a trial wave function. Okay, how to construct the trial wave function? We can construct the trial wave function by using the LCAO approximation. What is meant by that? See, we have two atomic orbitals here. I am going to take the two atomic orbitals. Okay, and I am going to combine them linearly so that we will get the trial wave function psi1. How to combine? Very simple. See, you multiply this phi1 with some coefficient. Let me represent that as C11, and multiply phi2 with some coefficient C12. Okay, see, phi1, phi2 are atomic orbital wave functions which are already known. Okay, what are the quantities unknown here? C11 and C12 are unknowns. So if you calculate C11 and C12, yes, it is possible to calculate or it is possible to find the wave function of the pi molecular orbital psi 1. Okay, that is phi 1, pi 1. Similarly, the wave function for the second pi molecular orbital, that is pi 2 star, I'll represent that as psi 2. Okay, we can also construct this wave function, right? We can also construct this trial wave function by using the linear combination of phi 1 and phi 2. So what I'm going to do, I'll multiply phi 1 by some coefficient C21 and phi 2 by some coefficient C22. Okay, so if you calculate these coefficients C11, C12, C21, C22, then our job is over. Because the ultimate goal of this Uccle molecular orbital method is to find the wave functions of the molecular orbital. So we need to find psi 1 and psi 2. So here, listen, psi 1 and psi 2, okay, they are wave functions of pi molecular orbitals. Okay, and here this wave function psi 1 is given as C11 phi 1 plus C12 phi 2, and this is called the trial wave function. Okay, so this is the trial wave function for psi 1 and this is the trial wave function for psi 2. Okay, what we are going to do? Using this trial wave function, we are going to calculate the minimum possible energy for the pi molecular orbitals. Okay, so first I am going to take psi 1, the trial wave function psi 1, okay, and using variation method I am going to calculate the energy of the pi molecular orbital pi 1, or the energy correspond to the molecular orbital psi 1. Okay, then I am going to take the trial wave function psi 2, and I am going to apply variation method. Okay, using that method I am going to calculate the minimum possible energy for the molecular orbital correspond to psi 2. Okay, yeah, so we are going to use what is called the variation method here, but we are going to use variation method. Okay, but before going to apply this variation method, okay, one thing I like to say, see, the variation method that you apply for psi 1 and psi 2 are exactly the same. The procedure is exactly same. Therefore, what we do normally is we won't apply variation method for psi 1, psi 2 separately. Okay, instead, what I'm going to do is that, let me write the general molecular orbital wave function. Okay, let the general molecular orbital wave function, okay, let me represent the general molecular orbital wave function psi equal to C1 phi 1 plus C2 phi 2. Right, let us not worry about the labels correspond to the molecular orbitals. Okay, I have taken the coefficients simply C1 and C2, right? Once we finish the calculation, we'll go back to the original equation and we'll put the coefficients as required for the molecular orbitals. Okay, see, what I'm trying to say, Psi1 and Psi2 are the trial wave functions. Actually, we have to apply variation method for Psi1 separately, variation method for Psi2 separately. But the procedure that we are going to follow is exactly the same. All the equations, expression, everything remains same. Therefore, instead of doing the method, or instead of doing the calculation for Psi1, Psi2 separately, okay, we'll do the calculation with some general molecular orbital wave function. Okay, and using that, you can get the wave function Psi1, Psi2, right, by introducing the coefficients again, introducing the proper coefficients. Okay, yeah, yes, how to proceed. See, so this is the trial wave function now, general trial wave function. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to apply the variation method. Okay, so according to variation method, the expectation energy, right, for the jth molecular orbital, for the jth molecular orbital, let me represent this simply as epsilon j. Energy of the jth molecular orbital is given as integral, or the I'll write in the bracket notation, rho of psi, then effective Hamiltonian, then psi, this is simply psi, not psi 1, I'm sorry, psi, okay, then here also psi divided by rho of psi and ket of psi, okay. So this is an integral. If you calculate this integral, you'll end up with the two secular equations, okay, because we have two atomic orbitals are involved and we have two coefficients here. So while doing the while applying variation method, at one stage we will differentiate this this expression with the coefficient c1 and we'll put the value equal to 0. You will get one secular equation. Then we'll differentiate the wave function the energy with the c2 and we'll put the value equal to 0. We'll get another secular equation. Okay, I'm not going to do all the steps because which are all very simple. So I'm going to write the secular equations directly. Okay, so there are two coefficients involved, therefore we'll get two secular equations. Okay, yeah, so the secular equations are secular equations. Okay, let me write here H11 minus EJ into S11 into C1 plus H12 minus EJ into S12 into C2 equal to 0. This is one secular equation. Similarly, we'll get another secular equation, H21 minus EJ into S21 C1 plus H22 minus EJ S22 into C2 equal to 0. This is second secular equation. Okay. Now, our goal is to find the coefficient C1 and C2. Our goal is to find the coefficient C1 and C2. Okay. See, these two equations are valid if I put C1 0 and C2 0. Correct? If I put C1 0 here, this becomes 0. If I put C2 also 0, then the entire left hand side becomes 0. Correct? We want the left hand side quantity supposed to be equal to 0. Correct? According to the equation. Therefore, these two equations are valid, okay, if C1 is 0 and C2 is 0. But the trial wave function that you have chosen here, okay, it contains C1 and C2. Suppose if you put C1 0, C2 0, then your molecular orbital wave function becomes 0, which is not actually applicable, okay, which is not applicable, or which is not correct. Okay, we need the coefficients should be non-zero. Okay, so to get non-zero coefficients, we have to find the non-trivial solutions. What is meant by that? See, these two linear equations, okay, you can convert them into matrix by using matrix algebra. Let me write in the next page. Okay, so using matrix algebra, we can convert the two linear equations into matrices. How? H11 minus EJ into S11, then H12 minus EJ into S12, then H21 minus EJ into S21, H22 minus EJ into S22, into C1 into C2, equal to 0, 0. We can convert the secular equations, right? They are actually linear equations. We can convert the two linear equations into matrices using matrix algebra. Okay, see, the one possible solution is C1 should be 0 and C2 should be 0. If C1, C2, 0, yes, this equation is valid. We call this as trivial solution. Trivial solution, but we don't want trivial solution. Why? If C1 0, C2 0, then the molecular orbital wave function also becomes 0. Okay, which is not possible actually. Therefore, we don't want trivial solution. Okay, to get non-trivial solution, what we do, see, this is actually very simple matrix algebra. You might have seen this in your mathematics classes. So I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to give you the complete detail of that. Instead, I'm going to apply the method directly. To get the non-trivial solution, what we have to do, listen, this quantity, the determinant of this quantity, okay, if it is zero, then non-trivial solution exists. Okay, so what I'm trying to say, h11 minus ej into s11, h12 minus ej into s12, then h21 minus ej into s21, h22 minus ej into s22. If this determinant is zero, then non-trivial solution exists. Okay, yeah, so we have to keep the determinant zero to get the non-trivial solution. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to apply the Huckel's approximation. Okay, yes, what is the Huckel's approximation? You know very well, according to Huckel's approximation, HII represent an integral. It is called the Coulomb integral, which means the energy of an electron, okay, when it is present in 2pz atomic orbital of carbon. See, if you have a sp2 carbon with one 2pz orbital having one electron, what is the energy of this electron? This electron is interacting with the nucleus of the carbon and the sigma electrons, sigma bonding electrons. Okay, and this interaction energy is given by the integral HII. And the value of HII according to variation method, according to Huckel's approximation, it is given a value of alpha. Okay, so this is called Huckel's approximation. Huckel's is Huckel's approximation. Okay, HII equal to alpha. Right, and so here H11 and H22 both are equal to alpha. Then what about H12? Right, suppose, or in general HIJ. Okay, let me write the next page, or here itself I'll write. Okay, what is HIJ? HIJ, listen, if I and J are equal, if I and J are not directly bonded, ith carbon atom and jth carbon atom, if I and J not directly bonded, we don't have less space, so let me write to the next page itself. Right. So, what about the second integral? This also we know, already have discussed about that. Anyway, so HIJ is called resonance integral. Okay, and the value of resonance integral, it is beta if ith carbon and jth carbon, I and J, okay, ith carbon and jth carbon are directly bonded. Directly bonded. This is equal to zero if I and J are not directly bonded. Not directly bonded. Okay? Yeah. See, what is the meaning? The meaning is this. If we have two carbon atom, adjacent carbon atom, both are sp2, okay, and assume that we have an electron in the 2pz orbital, right? This electron is interacting with the nucleus of this carbon, and this electron also interact with the nucleus of this carbon, okay, during the overlap of the atomic orbitals, right? So what is the energy of an electron when it is interacting with the nucleus of adjacent carbon and the sigma framework? Okay, this energy is what we called as resonance energy. Okay, right? If the two carbon atoms are adjacent carbon, then this interaction will be very high. And the value is given as, we will get some value which is given as beta. But if you take carbon 1 and carbon 3, right, then the interaction become, the interaction of the electron with the carbon nucleus of carbon 1 and nucleus of carbon 3, which is far away, okay, therefore this interaction is almost negligible and it is considered as zero. Okay, so it's the right assumption. Therefore, in ethene, the value H12 and the value H21, see this carefully, carbon 1, carbon 2 in ethene, we have only two carbon atoms and they are directly bonded. Therefore, the value of this integral is beta and this integral also beta. Okay, and what about the other integrals, SII? SII is called normalization integral. Since the atomic orbital phi1 and phi2 that we are going to use here, they are all normalized wave function. Therefore, SII value should be 1 always. So, S11 equal to 1, S22 also equal to 1. Okay, then what about Sij? It is called the overlap integral. And I have told you already, in Huckel molecular orbital treatment, in simple Huckel molecular orbital treatment, overlap integral is assumed to be 0. Okay, therefore, S12 is 0, S21 also 0. Right, now let me apply these values in the secular determinant. So, the secular determinant, so let me write the secular determinant once again. H11 minus Ej into S11, H12 minus Ej into S12, then H21 minus Ej into S21, H22 minus Ej into S22 equal to 0. So this is the secular determinant we had in the last page. Now I am going to apply the Huckel's approximation. So according to Huckel's approximation, H11 value is alpha minus S11 value is 1, therefore 1 into Ej is Ej, right? Then H12, since the carbon 1 and carbon 2 are directly bonded, so the value is beta. And S12 is 0, therefore this becomes 0. Okay, so we'll get only beta here. Similarly, if you apply the Huckel's approximation here, we'll get beta here and we'll get alpha minus Ej here, which is equal to 0. Okay, now what I'm going to do, I'm going to divide the first row by beta and second row also by beta. Okay, if you divide the first row by beta, correspondingly you have to divide in the right hand side also by beta. But in the right hand side we have only 0. So, if you divide the first row by beta and second row by beta, okay, right hand side remains the same. Okay, so after dividing by beta, we'll get alpha minus Ej by beta. Here we'll get 1. Here we'll get 1. Here we'll get alpha minus Ej by beta equal to 0. Okay. Now, I'm going to put this alpha minus Ej by beta. I'm going to take this value as x. Okay, if I put this value here, I'll get x11x, I'll get a determinant like this, right? Now how to simplify the determinant? You know very well, cross multiply these two, so you'll get x square, then minus 1 into 1, 1 equal to 0, x square minus 1 equal to 0, therefore x square equal to 1 or x is equal to plus 1 or minus 1. So we'll get two roots for this determinant. Okay, we'll get two roots. The roots are x is equal to plus 1 or minus 1. And you know very well, alpha minus Ej by beta is x actually, right? Therefore, we can write, I'll just modify this equation and let me write Ej directly. Therefore, Ej is equal to alpha, okay, minus beta into x. I have just rearranged this equation. See, you just multiply this here, you'll get beta into x. Bring this plus beta x to the left hand side and minus Ej to the right hand side. You will get this expression. Okay, now if x is equal to plus 1, if x is equal to plus 1, if I put plus 1 here, I'll get Ej equal to alpha minus beta. This is energy of one molecular orbital. And if I put x is equal to minus 1, then I'll get Ej equal to, if I put minus 1 here, minus of minus become plus, so I'll get alpha plus beta. So you'll get the energies of the two molecular orbitals. Okay, but which one is lower energy, which one is higher energy, how to compare? Remember, alpha value and beta value, okay, in Hückel molecular orbital treatment, alpha values and beta values are always negative values. Okay, if both are negative, then see, if I put negative value here and negative value here, then the net value become more negative. That means alpha plus beta will give me the lowest energy and alpha minus beta will give the corresponding higher energy. Okay, so I am going to take this one as E1. In the place of J, I'll put E1 and here I'll put E2. E1 is the lower energy molecular orbital because alpha and beta are negative values, and E2 is the next higher energy molecular orbital. Okay, so we have found out the energies of the molecular orbitals. I'll go back. So we get two molecular orbitals by the linear combination of atomic orbitals, pi 1, and the second one is pi 2 star. Okay, and the energy of the lower molecular orbital, energy of the lower molecular orbital is represented as epsilon 1, and the energy of the higher molecular orbital is epsilon 2. What is epsilon 1? Epsilon 1 is alpha plus beta, and epsilon 2 is alpha minus beta. Okay, in the ground state, see, in ethene molecule we have only two pi electrons. One pi bond is there. One pi bond means two pi electrons. In the ground state, both the pi electrons are present in the lower energy molecular orbital. You know very well, each molecular orbital can accommodate two electrons. Okay, so in the ground state, both the electrons are present in the lower energy molecular orbital. So energy of each electron, for electron 1, the energy is alpha plus beta. For electron 2 also the same energy. Therefore, what is the pi electronic energy of the molecule? Pi electronic energy. Pi electronic energy of the molecule. Let me write this as E pi. What is the pi electronic energy? We have two electron and both electrons are present in lower energy molecular orbital whose energy is E1. Therefore, pi electronic energy is 2 into E1. Or 2 into what is E1? E1 is nothing but alpha plus beta. Therefore, pi electronic energy of ethene is 2 alpha plus 2 beta. This is the pi electronic energy of ethene. Right? Now, you may ask a question. Why does ethene molecule form pi bond? Why not these two pz orbitals with one known electron remains as such? If they remain as such, okay, they can remain separately, right? Without any bonding and all, right? Why does these two atomic orbital combine and form pi bond? What's the necessity? Listen, the formation of pi bond stabilizes the system. How can we explain this? Very simple. Listen, suppose if there is no bonding between the two pz orbital, then energy of this electron is alpha. Okay, if an electron present in 2pz orbital of sp2 carbon, then the energy of that electron is alpha. Similarly, energy of this electron is alpha. Therefore, if there is no bonding occur between the 2p orbital, then the total energy of the two electrons would be 2 alpha. But due to the formation of pi bond, the total pi electronic energy now is equal to 2 alpha plus 2 beta. And the difference will give you what is called the bonding energy. Okay, so what is the bonding energy? Let me write pi bonding energy. What is the pi bonding energy of ethene? Let me write this as B pi. B pi means pi bonding energy of ethene, right? Which is nothing but the pi electronic energy of ethene minus, okay, if the two orbitals do not overlap, okay, do not combine, then the the expected energy is supposed to be 2 alpha, right? So pi electronic energy is 2 alpha plus 2 beta minus 2 alpha. So 2 alpha, 2 alpha cancel, you'll get the answer is 2 beta. So 2 beta is the pi bonding energy of ethene, and here beta is negative, therefore this quantity is negative. What does it indicate? This much energy of the system is decreased due to the formation of pi bond. You know very well, when energy decreases, stability will increase. Okay, this is one way of saying stability, right? Stability through energy. Whenever energy of the system decreases, stability will increase. So the necessity for the formation of pi bond is to make the system more stable. Okay, yeah. So now you know what is the pi electronic energy of ethene, and you also know what is the pi bonding energy of ethene, right? I stop here. The next class I'll show you how to get the wave functions of the pi molecular orbitals, okay, having energy alpha plus beta and alpha minus beta. Okay. Thank you for listening.